Hey everyone, this is Zach with 8020 Media, back today with another common problems guide, and today we're going to be focusing on the BMW N55 3-liter inline six single turbocharged engine. The BMW N55 was the successor to BMW's N54 engine. Now, the N54, we made a video on that recently. Anyone familiar with the N55 or researching the N55 has also likely come across the N54 on numerous occasions. Both of the engines are kind of lumped together and commonly compared, and there's always a lot of kind of bickering and jokes back and forth between the N54 and N55 communities. So these engines are very closely related, and so we'll surely reference the N54 a couple times throughout this video, and in the future do a couple more videos related to some of the differences between these engines and which one is truly better depending on your goals and needs. Looking at the N55 specifically, again, it was a successor to the N54. So the N55 was designed in 2010 and was primarily produced from 2010 until 2015, when it was then phased out by the BMW B58, the newest iteration of the 3-liter turbocharged engine family. One side note, the N55 was around a little bit longer. It was in the BMW M2 for a couple years, interestingly, until BMW decided to put their S55 engine into the BMW M2. But looking at the N55 here specifically, we're looking at the basic version, not the one in the M2, even though it is the same design structurally. There were a number of changes to support the different focus of the M2, such as taking it to the track and making a bit more power. So there were a number of changes. So we're mostly just looking at the base N55 here, which shares a lot in common with the BMW N54. They both share the same bore, the same stroke, the same compression ratio at 10.2 to 1. So they have the exact same displacement. They both share a 7,000 RPM redline. The main difference moving to the N55 from the N54 is BMW actually switched from a true twin turbocharged design to the N55 being a single twin scroll turbocharger. It produces anywhere from 300 to 335 horsepower and 300 to 332 pound-feet of torque. And the most common output is going to be the 300 horsepower, 300 torque, so exactly the same as the previous generation BMW N54. In the bulk of models, again, some get up to 335 horsepower. Ultimately, not too much else background-wise to give on the N55. In this video, we'll do kind of more complete guides since we have tons of content on the N55. So jumping right into problems with the BMW N55 engine, one thing that we consider a misconception is a lot of people say that the N55 was a significant reliability improvement over the N54, which if you saw that video we made, the N54 does not score great remarks for reliability. It's terrible in a lot of regards. And unfortunately, the N55 shares a lot of those same flaws. So a couple things that BMW did at least fix moving from the N54 to the N55 is on the N55, the turbochargers generally a lot more reliable. BMW switched the injectors from a piezo style injector on the N54 to a solenoid style injector on the N55. So those injectors are generally a lot cheaper on the N55 if they do fail, and they're a lot more reliable in general, so they don't often run into any issues or failures. Otherwise, the high pressure fuel pump was a major issue on the N54, which for the most part was fixed on the N55. Very early model 2011 versions of the N55 did have a couple high pressure fuel pump issues, but from there on out, it was mostly resolved. However, kind of comparing it again to the N54 quickly, a lot of those problems on the N54, like turbos and fuel injectors and the high pressure fuel pump, have long-term solutions that are just as reliable and as effective as the N55. And outside of that stuff, really the N55 runs into a lot of the same problems. So starting right off the bat, one major issue with the N55 is going to be carbon buildup. Due to the direct injection nature, the N55 does produce a lot of oil blow-by, which builds up on the intake ports and valves. As that builds up, it restricts airflow into the cylinders and can cause some drivability issues, rough idle, power loss. Usually that's something that should be dealt with. Those intake valves should be cleaned, generally walnut blasted every 60 to 80,000 miles. You might even want to do it a little bit sooner if you want to ensure you're kind of getting the maximum performance and efficiency out of the N55. You could even wait until 100,000 plus miles if you're less concerned with that. The good news is carbon buildup generally doesn't cause any long-term reliability or longevity issues. So it's mostly just kind of that drivability and performance related stuff that it begins affecting after roughly the 60,000 mile mark. When that buildup becomes significant enough to start restricting airflow into the engine, sapping some power, causing rough idle potentially, some stuttering hesitation while accelerating. So very common issue, something that should be dealt with on most N55s, especially if you're buying one for performance reasons, but not something that should really affect overall reliability or longevity. Next up, just like the N54 and the N52, the BMW N55 3-liter engine suffers from quite a few common oil leaks. So the top three areas for that are going to be the oil pan gasket, the oil filter housing gasket, and then the valve cover gasket. All of these oil leaks pretty frequently pop up in the 70, 80,000 to about 120,000 mile ballpark. The N55 can run into other oil leaks, especially as they're aging now. Front and rear main seals occasionally leak, but much less common than the oil pan, oil filter housing, and valve cover gasket oil leaks. So not really serious issues, not stuff that needs to be dealt with as soon as possible or immediately. Still best to get those oil leaks fixed within a reasonable time frame. Again, all very common leaks once you get past that 80-ish thousand mile mark. Moving on to the next set of issues, just like the BMW N54, the N55 suffers from a number of cooling system issues. That includes cracked coolant expansion tanks, cracked radiators, cracked coolant hoses, water pump failures, thermostat issues, electric cooling fan problems. Basically, anything related to the cooling system can have problems and frequently does have problems. Things like the water pump, those are probably the most well-known cooling system issue, as those electronic water pumps give out as soon as 40 or 50,000 miles. Generally, they should make it to about 80,000 miles, and the lucky few will make it past that 100,000 mile mark, but certainly one of the more common issues. Once you start pushing past 100,000 miles, that's when you're gonna start to see issues like the electric cooling fan, radiator problems, cracked coolant hoses, cracked coolant expansion tank, mostly above the 100,000 mile mark. But again, main point here is pretty much anything in that cooling system, anything related to the N55 cooling system is fair game at this point in time. With the kind of age and mileage most of these engines have, you're gonna run into a few cooling system issues more likely than not. Moving on to the next issue is Vanos solenoids. We discussed this for the N52 and N54 as well. Fairly simple, those Vanos solenoids control the variable valve timing. They have oil flowing through them generally over time. They could either fail electronically or that oil starts to kind of gunk and build up within the solenoid and starts to run into problems. So that's generally something you'll see in the 80 to 120,000 mile ballpark. Solenoids are fairly inexpensive and cleaning them does sometimes work as a short-term solution. But if you wanna kind of fix that for the longer term, or at least for the next, 80,000 plus miles, then it's best to just go ahead and replace the Vanos solenoids altogether. So that about sums it up, surely skipping over some things. I mean, we lumped a lot of it together here with, multiple oil leaks kind of lumped into one thing and a lot of cooling system issues lumped into one kind of category. But again, the N55 is much like the N54 in the sense that anything outside of the engine is prone to failure. Again, the turbos, the fuel injectors, and the high pressure fuel pump are generally a bit more reliable than the N54. That's not always true nowadays once you have some of these N54s that have updated fuel pumps, updated injectors. Those are kind of long-term solutions. So these engines are really kind of in a same ballpark or same spot in terms of reliability, especially looking at all the stuff outside the engine, like the gaskets and oil leaks and the entire cooling system running into issues. One thing on the N55 that isn't fair to call a common problem, this doesn't happen very often, but it is interesting because there are quite a few more known cases of this on the N55 as compared to the N54, and that is issues with the rod bearings. Rod bearings, and really internally, the N54 is known to be incredibly reliable, very stout, rarely runs into any internal issues unless you, you know, start pushing extreme power. The N55 is a little bit different, and there have been more cases of rod bearing failures, and obviously that can lead to complete engine replacement, complete engine failure. So it's a pretty serious issue. Again, this is not truly a common problem. It's still, you know, very rare and you know, limited cases of it, but it's something that's more common than on the BMW N54. And so that's one area that the advantage really goes to the N54 internally, simply because we haven't seen quite the number of failures on N54s as we have with the N55. And most of those failures come down to the rod bearings. Ultimately here, the BMW N55 earns below average remarks for reliability. BMW made a couple good improvements over the N54 that cut out a lot of the costly issues like turbochargers and fuel injectors. A couple of those design aspects were much improved on the N55. The trade-off was it took a little bit of a hit, a little bit of a cut in performance, even though it makes the same kind of power in stock form as the N54 once you start modifying. Mod for mod, the twin turbo N54 is the more capable engine. That's not to say anything bad about the N55 or that it isn't still a very capable engine, because it is. You can still pretty easily get, you know, upwards or beyond 400 wheel horsepower on the stock turbo, especially on the later EWG models, which are the electronic wastegates. The older 2011 to mostly 2013 models used pneumatic wastegates, and those weren't quite as capable as the later N55 models. But ultimately, circling back to reliability here, again, this engine is in the modern times not much more reliable than an N54, especially if you compare it to an N54 that has, you know, upgraded turbos or aftermarket turbos, the newest index 11 or 12 injectors, and the newest high pressure fuel pump designs. Otherwise, the N55 suffers from a ton of problems around the engine, the cooling system, a bunch of oil leaks, Vanos solenoids, the serpentine belt can be an issue as well, carbon buildup, the full list basically, you know. Again, a lot of the stuff around the engine internally, it's still a stout engine, apart from a couple random rod bearing failures that seem a bit more common. But ultimately, N55 receives, you know, below average remarks for reliability, not the most reliable engine out there. If you're looking for a great performance engine, the N55 can get the job done. If you're looking for a reliable engine, then we would recommend looking at the newer BMW engines like the B48 or the B58. Or going with a naturally aspirated engine like the BMW N52. I think that about wraps it up for our BMW N55 Common Problems Guide. And if you guys like the content, please hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, check out the description below, and go to our website. We have a ton more content on the BMW N55, tons of modding guides, all the various bolt-ons, and we'll surely be back with more videos on the BMW N55. In the meantime, thanks for tuning in, and check back for more videos in the near future.